Hello everyone, my name is Alantina and I'm a PhD student at the University of Cambridge. My research focuses on organizational behavior, artificial intelligence, and the future of work. In today's video, we'll talk about the notion of AI taking over our jobs, we'll go through three questions of how to assess it, take a closer look at AI in medicine, and end with some thoughts on where humans excel. When we hear about AI in the news or read about it online, what do we often see? The narrative tends to be something like, is AI going to take over our jobs? Or, you know, will AI make humans obsolete? I think we already know that media likes to sensationalize these things. So my question to you would be, what do you think? Is AI really going to take over your job? Does it really have the power to make you obsolete? What are some steps that we can take? What are some skills that we can attain to strengthen our position and career outlook? It's quite interesting because as I started delving more into AI research, I couldn't help but read more philosophy on what intelligence entails, of what it means to be human. You know, what is human uniqueness? Is creativity a strength only reserved for humans? Or can AI also be creative? We know that AI can learn, but can it learn the way that humans do? And will it eventually be able to learn things within historical and societal contexts? Is that even necessary for a machine? Is the machine simply processing information or is it actually learning? And do we even need AI systems to mimic human intelligence? Might it benefit society if we create machines that learn differently than humans so that machines can actually complement how and what we learn? There are just so many questions to ask, right? But yes, I'm sure many of you who are interested in AI are also drawing from philosophy and psychology and linguistics and neuroscience and ethics. Because to really understand the impact of AI, you can't look at it in isolation as just a branch of computer science. And through these discussions, I'll embed these philosophical and psychological perspectives. But if we're to try to answer these questions about whether or not AI will take over our jobs in a more practical fashion, we could say one, we need to have a clear understanding of what the job entails, so job description, tasks, etc. Two, we need to know what the strengths of AI are as it relates to that particular job. And three, we need to know how AI can be applied to that particular job. Now, these are very basic but fundamental questions, so let's get into it. It might be easy to illustrate this with one running example, so let's use physicians for this one. Going back to this concept of AI hype, if we're to discuss AI in the context of medicine, we can't just blindly say that AI is going to replace physicians, which, not surprisingly, I'm sure you'll find plenty of articles promoting this narrative. Also, a quick side note here, a lot of the AI that's currently used in healthcare at the moment is for administrative tasks such as scheduling appointments, digitalizing records, medical records, and reminder systems to call or email patients about appointments and prescriptions. So when you see the headlines that say something like, AI is revolutionizing medicine, look for a description of the AI system to see if it's more administrative, research for drug development, or if it's diagnostics and surgery. Okay, when we look at the overall job, in this case, a physician's job, we need to have a clear understanding of what the job entails so as to know how AI might take over or not of this position. We can also look at it through a positive lens of how AI can benefit physicians. So to cover the first part, we could say a physician's job description is to diagnose and treat injuries or illnesses. And how do they do this? By examining the patient, taking into consideration the patient's medical history to provide a holistic approach to the problem, by requesting diagnostic tests, interpreting the test, and when necessary, recommending the patient to go and see a specialist. In addition, physicians also counsel their patients on steps needed to prevent or cure the illness. And depending on the severity of the illness, it may be a simple process of recommending lifestyle and diet changes, or it could be prescribing medication, or if it's very severe, then performing surgery. So now that we have a gist of what the job entails, the second step is to look at which aspects of a physician's job can be diverted to an AI system. And for that, we need to have an awareness of the diverse applications of AI available today, specifically in medicine. So does the physician rely on imaging data? If yes, we have AI systems that diagnose tests. This is often used in radiology, pathology, dermatology, and ophthalmology. More specifically, radiology has been the one that's been most open to this, to using AI. Traditionally, what radiologists do is they assess x-rays and CT scans and MRIs to detect, characterize, and monitor diseases. But now, thanks to deep learning, we have AI systems that can screen hundreds, if not thousands, of images. It can recognize complex patterns within the data and provide diagnostic predictions for the physician to assess. The wonderful thing about AI is that it can integrate and analyze data from multiple sources to capitalize on the availability of data. And these different sources of data are not just medical images, but also other medical tests, and where necessary, genomics tests, and also data from medical devices that patients are using to monitor their heart rate or sleep or whatever other data that the device is capable of gathering. The next question. So if the physician is a surgeon, another question to ask would be, do we have AI that performs surgery? And the answer is yes, especially for surgeries that require high levels of precision, like in urology or gynecology, or even in heart surgery. Physicians can now use a robotic surgery arm. And how it works is the surgeon views a 3D image of the surgical field, and he or she has a console where they can control the surgery from a distance. Traditionally, for example, heart surgery has been done through open surgery, where doctors have to do a long incision down the center of your chest and cut through your breastbone to be able to perform the surgery. But now with robotic surgery, it's minimally invasive. We can insert robotic surgical arms and a camera through a very tiny incision and use these robotic arms to perform surgery while viewing the details on a screen from a distance. So now that we've covered what a physician's job entails, what the strengths of AI are for their line of work, and how it can be applied, our last question should be, what percentage of these tasks are central to the job? What I mean by this is, if the AI is excelling at medical diagnoses, we need to ask, do medical diagnoses take up 20% of a physician's job, 50%, 70%? Because the AI of today is very narrow. It can only do one specialized task at a time. And we all know that in any job, whether that's a physician or a lawyer or an engineer or any other profession, there are multiple tasks that comprise the entirety of one's work. If AI is excellent at performing one particular task, we have to ask, to what extent is my job defined by that particular task? If it's a significant portion, then we can say, okay, the future of this profession is a bit rocky. And if it isn't, then we can say it's a lot safer. It won't be taken over by AI, not anytime soon. So let's refer back to the physician example. We see that AI is great at analyzing complex medical data. It's great at finding patterns in diagnostic reports. And robotic surgical arms are wonderful for performing complex surgeries. But even knowing all of this, we still can't make the bold statement that AI will replace physicians, because a physician's job isn't only to perform surgery or only to assess diagnostic tests. Where AI is weak, humans are strong. And AI lacks the human approach. It lacks the situational and historical context and understanding that is often needed to assess, cure, or prevent disease. Our current systems are so narrow in scope that when it comes to health, we need to have more of a systems mindset to holistically assess the illness and holistically cure or prevent it. We can't look at any illness or injury in isolation. Physicians don't just assess patients' physical ailments, but they take into consideration the patient's mental well-being, their lifestyle, external stressors, and a number of other factors that no machine can do. So instead of talking about how AI will replace jobs, it's more useful to run through these questions for our own profession and see where the differences lie between humans and machines. By doing so, we can shift our focus to how AI can be used to augment human work and how AI can be used for our own good to make us better and to make society better. And an important point, one that I'd like to end this video on, is the need for everybody to be a part of this conversation, to be a part of building AI systems. Working together with engineers, we can build AI that truly supports employees. Because although engineers will have all the technical skills to build the latest and the greatest AI systems, it's the people on the ground, it's the people who are day in and day out doing the job who will truly know what is needed of an AI system to transform their work. And through these conversations with professionals and engineers, we can create AI systems that can be used not just to make our jobs better, but really for the greater good of humanity. And that's it for today. Thank you so much for spending your time with me. I look forward to making more of these videos where I can share my research and ideas with you. If you learned one new thing from this video, please consider liking, subscribing, and sharing it. I think I will make maybe about 8 or 10 more in this AI series, so keep an eye out in the coming weeks. And this is a new channel, so the likelihood of YouTube suggesting this video is slim to none. And I truly appreciate it if you can help by sending it to 3 friends and sharing it on your social channels. I wish you the most wonderful day, and thank you again for spending it here with me. Take care, and God bless. Until next time. Bye.